I clearly made a mistake putting that computer in his room. I allowed the computer to become too much of his life. My son had these online relationships going on that were completely invisible to me. Right after Christmas, we got into a routine. We would go down into the basement after dinner and we put on the red boxing gloves. And we had this conversation one night and said, now, Ryan, you know how to fight. The last thing I want to see happen now is that you now start picking fights at school. Don't ever want to learn that you're now the bully. But I did say to him, I said, Ryan, if that kid or any of his friends ever lay a single finger on you, you've got my full permission to wail on them.
After that, things got better. Ryan told his parents the bullying had stopped. But then, in October of 2003, he killed himself.
You know, all I kept saying, asking myself was why? Why? You know, I kept crying, why, Ryan, why did you do this?
Anybody who would look at him as a child and then have a crystal ball and see into the future as to how he would die, you just wouldn't believe it.
Yay! I started to say, okay, there has to be something here. At the time, I was concerned about what everybody was concerned about, predators and pedophiles, right? I mean, that was what the media was talking about. You heard the horror stories. I thought, oh, let me go log on to his AOL account. Let me see if Brian's friends will open up to me online.
I saw Brian's screen name pop up, and I was really angry, actually. I thought someone was just playing a big joke. And to me, that was not funny at all.
All these instant messages started popping up. You know, who are you? What are you doing? This isn't funny. Get off of Ryan's account. And I was typing back as fast as I could. I'm Mr. Halligan. Is there anything anybody's willing to share with me that might explain why Ryan did what he did?
We just started talking about what I knew. People would say things to Ryan over the internet and at school, like, you were such a loser, and just really mean things.
Over the summer, Ryan had become the victim of a vicious cyberbullying campaign. One boy had started a rumor that Ryan was gay.
I didn't stick up for him at the time because I thought, you know, it was just that middle school bullying, it happened. But it was real, and it really hurt him.
You know, back in my day, if you're getting bullied, it ends at the schoolyard. You come home, then you have your safe haven. But not for Ryan. He came home and did what every other kid did. He went online, and then now the taunts got to continue at home as well.
The fun is like dropping the bomb, you know, oh, just kidding. And then that like crushed him. I mean, you wouldn't do that to someone's face, but online it's completely different. You can do whatever you want and no one can do anything. You're at your house, they're at their house. It's different.
There's something about reading words. You read it over and over again, and you start to believe it.
The words make it real. One kid told me, you never know if it's your best friend or your worst enemy that's doing this, because so much of it comes to you anonymously. So you never know who to trust.
As the days turned into weeks, John probed deeper into his son's online life. He discovered a folder on Ryan's computer containing a series of conversations between Ryan and a boy with a screen name he didn't recognize.
The two of them were spending a lot of time exchanging information that they were finding online that had to do with suicide and death. They found one website that taught you how to hang yourself. So it gave you how to tie the noose.
There was a website that Ryan and this boy visited and they commiserated on, that you plug in your personality traits and what you like and dislike, and then they spit out the best way you can commit suicide.
The most chilling conversation was actually a very short one. Ryan started off saying, "Tonight's the night I think I'm gonna do it." And the kid fired back, "It's about blank in time."
Two weeks later, in the early morning of October 7th, 2003, Ryan's sister found him hanging from a noose in his bathroom. In the weeks that followed, John felt compelled to track down the boy he thought might have been Ryan's co-conspirator.
I approached him online with Ryan's ID, and I said, "I'm Ryan's dad." I asked him, were you friends with Ryan? And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Did you guys ever talk about death and suicide?" And he said, "No." I just flat out asked him, "So what is your name?" And he gave me his real name. And while I still had him online, I called the house and I got the father on the phone and I introduced myself to him and I said, "I'm afraid that your son is perhaps thinking of doing what my son had done." The response was kind of weird. It was, he first said, "Well, I know nothing about computers. I don't have an email account, so you can't email this to me." And I said, "Well, I'd like to get it to you somehow." And he said, "Well, I'll have my wife call you when she comes home from work." That evening went by, I never got a call. Another day went by, no call.
4 years have gone by now, and John says he never got a satisfying response from the boy or his family. Occasionally, he still visits the boy's website, which is full of references to death and suicide.
I had so much unresolved pain, and I instinctively wanted somebody to pay for this. I wanted to blame somebody so desperately. Blame. I feel the computer, I can't blame the computer. The computer and the internet were not the cause of my son's suicide, but they helped. I believe they helped amplify and accelerate the hurt and the pain that he was trying to deal with that started in person in the real world.
Across the country, cases of cyberbullying have been springing up more and more. A few have ended in suicide. Most haven't. But it's clear that the internet has become a new weapon in the arsenal of adolescents, one that's not going away.
Starting to rain again, heaven is gone now, even the sun.